many of you are familiar with this. If not, you go home and you look it up on YouTube. So there I found myself, as many of you also probably did, suddenly bereft of three astonishing artists practically in one fell swoop. How to make sense of that? The annual Conference of Performance Studies International, PSI, in 2009 was held in Zagreb, Croatia. I was in Zagreb the day that Michael Jackson died. When I heard the news, the first thing I thought was, that's it. That's the first line of my novel. I was in Zagreb the day that Michael Jackson died. And in fact, those were precisely the first lines of the novel that I wrote to try to make sense of that and of the other incomprehensible losses that would follow. The novel that I wrote, that found its first line at an academic conference on performance studies, was a work of what I call fictocriticism, which is to say it's a work of fiction that attempts to perform critical dance studies. While I'd entered into the field, as I said, through ethnographic analysis of movement practices, my attention had always been focused on the figurative, narrative, and theoretical elements of dance, dance's own writerly maneuvers. And my own writing about it had, correspondingly, attempted to make use of both lyricism and personal narrative in order to contextualize that dance. Ethnography is a genre of academic writing that, in fact, often makes such moves. I earlier called Tristropique novelistic, and in fact, Lévi-Strauss often said that he'd hoped to write it as a novel, and his inability to fully allow himself to do so was another element of the melancholy of that text. Among contemporary scholars who embrace the notion of experimental, sometimes novelistic writing of cultural analysis, Michael Taussig, who taught for a time in my own department at performance studies at NYU, has been the most prolific and outspoken. The anthropologist Karen McCarthy Brown, who, like Randy, recently passed away, last year, also far too early, was another proponent of the incorporation of fictional or semi-fictional narrative into ethnography. But surely the most insightful, deft practitioner of fictocriticism was the extraordinary Zora Neale Hurston, who, as dance scholar Anthea Kraut has argued, was also deeply invested in dance's expressive potential. Dance studies and performance studies more generally have fostered much critical writing that draws attention to its own performativity. Among the most cited practitioners of performative critical writing are, I hardly need to tell this crowd, I think, Peggy Phelan, Susan Lee Foster, and Marta Siciliano. All of this is a meandering and somewhat apologetic way of saying that I'm hardly the first performance analyst or theorist to transgress the boundaries of what's understood to constitute scholarly writing. Our field, or fields, have long been remarkably open to experimental writerly tactics. It's perhaps simultaneously heartening and disheartening to consider that this may be, in part, inflected by the prevalence of women in the area of performance analysis. That is to say, it may be that a feminist sensibility helps dance and performance scholars to be able to recognize the potential value of alternative methodologies not based on notions of academic mastery and quantifiable knowledge. That would be the heartening conclusion. But it may also be that institutions allow for such freedom in part because they don't consider the stakes as high in disciplines dominated by women. We laugh, but it's true. I mean, there's an element of possibility there. Regardless of the reasons, my own inclination is to take liberties where we find them, and where we don't, to take them anyway, somehow finding room in those shifting tight places that I keep invoking. Sorry. Some of you, this is precisely the maneuver of the narrator of my novel, a dance scholar on a precarious postdoc at NYU, who explains, quote, "I'd been toying with the idea of writing fiction, probably as a way of avoiding the real task at hand, which was my academic writing. Given the economic climate and the disconcerting contraction of the university job market, the old saw, publish or perish, was taking on a new urgency." Now, this is where I say some of you in the room can probably relate. And maybe you can also relate to this. The other significant avoidance maneuver of my narrator is watching videos on YouTube, which is where he stumbles upon my dances, the dances I showed you. I already explained the genesis of the first couple of videos that I posted, but once I became involved in the project of analyzing them, and Michael Jackson, and Pina, and Merce, through the eyes of my narrator, I found myself creating more dances for him, for my narrator, constituting a kind of archive for him to work with. Effectively, these dances were clues to a mystery, and I ended up creating 12 of them. The only one that's not one of the dances for the novel is the booty clips one. Effectively, these dances were clues to a mystery, and I ended up creating 12 of them. Superficially, the mystery is a ridiculous one. Fully aware of his own probable delusion, my narrator becomes fixated on the theory of a serial killer behind the extermination of the greats of 20th century dance. That's just a cover, of course, for a much bigger and unsolvable existential, bless you, mystery, which is how to comprehend the mortality of the artists and the people that we love. But there's yet another question, which is the proper question that a dance scholar like my narrator, like myself, like you, should be trying to answer. What is it that dance can tell us that other expressive forms, including writing more narrowly construed, can't? As with that existential question about mortality, how do you make sense of that? We can never give a complete or satisfactory answer. But my way of getting at it was to keep working across that divide, to read my own dances and others, to write these readings through a fictional narrative, and then to read that fiction back through movement. So I'm not going to subject you to the full sequence, but in order to show you that this line of thinking and of writing and of dancing is actually quite a continuous one from my early preoccupations with the question of embodied forms of writing in Brazilian dance, I wanted to trace it through two more moments. One is another dance I made to one of Satie's Nociennes. This one is called Lent, and I'll show it to you and read over it my narrator's reading of the dance. So he views this on YouTube, and he writes the following. As the left hand arpeggiated the introductory chords, she kept her head dipped down, holding a kind of quiet, introverted fifth position. But when the right hand of the pianist began to tap out the repetitive single note of the opening phrase, she slowly and demurely swiveled her feet and hips into a syncopated little trip step, a weirdly abstracted, minimalist, and quickly abandoned gesturing of the samba. As Satie's arpeggios skipped up and down, she marked out corresponding gestures with her mudra-like hands pointing to her sex, umbilicus, nipples, and eyes. These gestures should have looked dirty, especially with that semi-transparent leotard, but in fact they seemed entirely pure. The only really licentious thing about the whole dance was its most balletic move when she rose up on demi-point and waggled there with her hands draped before her eyes. Her pubis rocked just slightly back and forth. It was utterly obscene. I thought of that essay by Susan Foster. Did I already waggle? Did I? The pubis waggled? Okay. Okay. My narrator, of course. The last line was from my narrator. I thought of that essay by Susan Foster. My narrator is referring, of course, to Foster's remarkable essay, The Ballerina's Phallic Point. And in this setting, I feel I can just allow my narrator to make that joke and say, enough said. last one, I promise, and I'll talk over this one as well. this one I'll play very quietly. I've already spilled the beans about the fake mystery and the real mystery of my novel, so I don't feel it's necessary to give you a spoiler alert regarding the last of the dances that I'm showing you, even though it's the last of the dances of the book. I give you a little volume. And it's the dance that ostensibly answers all the questions. Well, as you can imagine, the conspiracy theory was unfounded. The artist we loved died of medical irresponsibility, cigarettes, and natural causes. A creepy stalker with a ukulele turns out not to be a serial killer, but a bungling oddball artist, collaborator, and friend of the aging would-be ballerina and her crew of queer musician friends, all of who end up for the grand finale in her tub in a collective performance of The Girl from Ipanema. Can you even hear it a little bit? Maybe you think that if you read the book, I gather some people in the room have, but for those of you who haven't, maybe you think that if you read the book, this scene will be less baffling. But the truth is, probably not. The one narrative thing I should explain, though, is that the suspicious figure in the book, a dead ringer for Jimmy Stewart, did, both in the book and in real life, suggest to me that if I liked minimalism so much, and if I insisted on making these small chamber choreographies in my own home, maybe I should make a dance in my bathtub. Well, who could resist a challenge like that? There's another solo dance that takes place in the tub, and I enjoyed the constrictions so much, I ended up dragging all my friends in there with me. Not every dancer, I'm sorry, now I have to turn this down because I'm gonna actually make a point. That's sort of a recreation of that. Obviously, that's Samba in the Bathtub. Not every dancer chooses her tight places. Political constraints are often anything but pleasurable, and I don't mean to imply that all dancers can find them an enjoyable challenge. But I continue to work through both the dancerly and writerly tactics I learned watching women, in particular, push up against them through dance. It wasn't even entirely clear to me how significant those early dancing lessons were until I began to look for a through line in my work on dance, from ethnography to fiction. The dancing lesson I refer to is not actually the technical training I received at the Federal University of Bahia's dance department, nor the numerous times I was schooled in a roda de samba at a street party or in someone's home. The more significant dancing lesson, like Levi-Strauss's writing lesson, was the one about the underlying meaning of dancing itself, which is potentially a counter-argument to the grim conclusion that the primary function of written communication is to facilitate slavery. Certainly one of the functions of dance is to push against the very forms of political oppression which writing has imposed. And if we begin to acknowledge dance itself as a form of writing, of course, that changes everything. That's it. And